Blessed good morning, church. Good to have you here this Sunday morning, first Sunday in the month of April. The year is speeding along. We're so thankful to the Lord for his preservation. It's our desire to worship him in spirit and in truth this morning. And so as you make your way into the building, we want to do so with hearts that are preparing for worship together. And so while you do that, we're going to go ahead and have this morning's announcements. Our sister Alicia Hearwood, she's not feeling well, and so you want to continue to pray for her. She is on the up and up, though, so and she did say that she really felt the love, all of you who reached out and messaged her and so on. And so we're going to ask our treasurer, Esther, Lord Graham, to come and give this morning's announcements at this time.
Good morning, church. Welcome to those of you in the sanctuary, and welcome to those of you joining us online. Do we have any first-time visitors? Or any persons who haven't been in a long while? No, we don't. Okay, so let's go on to our birthdays and anniversaries for this week. Tomorrow we have Sydney Watson and Amy Emptage. And on Friday, we have Matthew Bovell and Peggy Forbes-Scott. We'd like to wish you all the best and have a blessed birthday. The Thanksgiving service for the life of Yvonne Piggott, mother of Sister Sandra Piggott, will be held here on Saturday at 2 p.m. Please continue to lift up our sister in prayer as she grieves the loss of her mother and continues to deal with her health challenges. The church has accepted an invitation from the Emmanuel Baptist Church to join them on this Thursday, April 11th at 7 p.m. as they celebrate their 53rd anniversary. They're hosting a rally. If you are interested in attending, please indicate on the sheet provided at the notice board at the back of the church. Ideally, we would like to meet here and proceed to the Emmanuel Baptist Church via bus, but we must know by Tuesday in order to work out the logistics. So if you do not place your name this morning or tonight, kindly advise the admin assistant tomorrow or Tuesday. The IBYC, Impacting and Building Youth of the Caribbean Planning Committee, would like to express thanks to those of you who attended the barbecue fundraising, the first in a series of fundraisers. The committee reports a profit of approximately $3,000 and invites you to join them. Thank you. And invites you to join them again on April 20th for the movie night. Additionally, you can place contributions, however small, in the envelopes that can be obtained from the ushers. Speaking of youth, please join me in congratulating our own Malik Sinclair. Is he here yet? Who captured the under 14 chess championship last weekend. In the finals, Malik won two matches outright and held another opponent to a draw, thus emerging a clear winner. Congrats, Malik. Incidentally, Malik is also one of our youth delegates to the IBYC conference. So we have some things, good things going on there. The Missions and Evangelism Ministry invites you to come out next Sunday, April 14th at 4:15 p.m. as they continue outreach to share the word and make disciples. If you are unable to join, please be in prayer for those members. Those joining for the first time are reminded to wear your Berean t-shirt and comfortable shoes. Finally, notices for the balance of the week. We meet again tonight at 6 p.m., where we continue our Ephesians series, and we're dealing with marriages. Wednesday at midday and 7:30 for our midweek prayer service. The choir usually meets on Thursday, but I'm thinking that they will be attending the rally at Emmanuel Baptist Church. Friday, the youth meet at 7. Next Sunday, Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship at 10:40, evening service at 6 p.m. These are the notices. Thank you and have a blessed week.
Thank you so much, Esther, for the announcements. At this time, we have the distinct privilege of including two more persons for membership in our church. And I'm going to invite them to the platform. That is going to be Ivan Paris and his sister Tamar Paris. Can you give them a warm welcome at this time? Amen. All right. So Galatians, I saw a verse there going to it. Yes, the right hand of fellowship. So certainly we rejoice with them and their interests in the Berean. Of course, we know that each person has a part to play. All right. And that's no pun intended because they play instruments. It just happens. Thank you. Yeah, I'm sorry, Francis. I'm sorry. But we want to ask God's grace upon their lives and encourage them in the Lord. As you know, they are well integrated into our church already and very much was a formality. Just going through the classes, they're excited. And in speaking with them, one of the things that they really appreciated about the Berean is the solid commitment to preaching God's word. Amen. And these young people, right? You know, I know, right? So that is something to give God thanks for. That's what they're looking for, right? And by the grace of God, they found it and we found them. And so we love you guys. We're grateful for you. And so let's just have a quick word of prayer and then we're going to invite the board and membership committee to come and greet them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity to be able to welcome Ivan and Tamar Paris to the membership of the Berean Bible Church. We thank you, Lord God, for how they have been serving already. We just pray, God, that you'll continue to multiply their gifts and their impact for the time that they will be with us. We are so thankful, Lord God, for adding them to our number. You are such a good God. May you continue, Lord God, to grow your church in number and in quality so that we will have more believers and better believers in this place for your glory. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. We're going to invite the board members and membership committee to come and extend the right hand of fellowship, right? COVID is kind of at the back burner right now, so we can actually shake hands this time, all right? God bless you guys. And so while they do that, I want to encourage you, if you are not yet a member of Berean Bible Church, you ought to be. And so if you're interested in that, you can let us know and indicate to myself, or you can call the office and say, I would like to join our church. So we had some visitors recently, and they put on the visitor's card, I want to become a member of Berean Bible Church. So you can join in at this opportunity. We just run a few classes. It takes about 3-4 classes, and then you're available to join. All right? So do take advantage of that opportunity. If you are not baptized, you know that you ought to be baptized. If you're a believer, then please also take advantage of that. Can we give a round of applause for Ivan and Tamar? I got to shake their hand too. Praise the Lord. All right, at this time, we're going to go ahead and have our moment's meditation and invite Deacon Tyrone to come.
Let's pray. Let's all stand for prayer. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Father, we thank you for the joy. We thank you for the pleasure. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings and peace of being able to come into your house of worship, to honor you, to magnify your name, to have fellowship with our brothers and sisters of like minds, and Father, to just enjoy your presence. Thank you for taking us through the past week. Thank you for bringing us today. And indeed, Lord, as we reflect on the week, it would have been a week that would have all sorts of circumstances. We would have had our ups and lows, moments of sickness, frustrations, moments, Lord, of hopelessness at times. But thank God we are where we are today, and we give you the credit and the praise for allowing us to be here today. And we want now to surrender ourselves, our morning, our day, our week to you, Lord, as we just concentrate on praising you and glorifying you this morning. You are a great God. You are the God of love and mercy, the God of purpose. And Lord, because you are who you are, life is worth the living. Accept our praise today. Accept our thanks. Have the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Deacon Lowe. Opening prayer of praise and adoration and invocation. Our first selection, all hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Now, we're going to be singing this selection, and is the thing about sound leading is that I can't sing the parts, okay? So it means that you guys have to sing them, all right? Now, some of you are going to sing the loud part and the soft part, and that's fine, right? That's good, right? But those of you who have the others down, go for it. For the glory of God, right? Not self. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Singing to our God, he is worthy. I invite you to remain standing as we sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. There is a bridge in here that we sung before, and you'll catch on to it quickly above all else. Come Thou Fount. after which we have our prayer of confession by Brother Richard Pierce. Somebody bless the Lord, please. Let me invite Brother Richard to come and pray at this time. Prone to wonder, that's what we feel. Prone to leave the God we love. Let's confess our sin to God at this time.
Good morning, church. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you are holy and are like no other, for all have sinned and fallen short of your glory. Your ways and thoughts are higher and greater than ours, and your judgments are perfect. Lord, we have sinned against you, but you are mighty in your saving of us. Lord God, you have commanded us to love you with all your heart, with all our heart, soul, and mind, and our neighbor as ourselves, but we continue to fall short. You have told us that if we love you, we will keep your word. But our love has been cold, and our own will has been directing our steps. We know that love rejoices in truth, yet we continue to find ourselves rejoicing in our works. We say we have fellowship with you, but we often walk alone and are not practicing your truth together. Father, lead us from temptation, that we might worship you as we ought to. Your command, you command us to make disciples, but we desire to rest in keeping peace and temporal comfort. Compel us, Father, to be faithful and diligent to preach your word, minister the gospel, and practice pure and undefiled religion as we ought to. Righteous Father, your will is for our sanctification. Hear our prayers, Father, and forgive our sins. Be merciful to us that we might find grace. All glory, all honor, and all praise be unto you, O God. For the sake of your holy name and for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I pray these things. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to John chapter 1, starting at verse 5. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Richard. You may be seated, everybody. Our next selection, Speak, O Lord. It's our desire to hear from God, and we do that primarily by his word. And so we're going to have our scripture readings after we sing these couple selections. Speak, O Lord, and amazing grace, my chains are gone.
Light of Christ might be seen today in our eyes.
Our next selection, let's stand together as we do this one because we're going to be sitting for our scripture readings. Amazing grace, my chains are gone. If you think that God's grace is amazing, I want to hear you guys sing on in this selection. My chains are gone, I've been set free, okay? How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace. 'Twas grace. To come now and give the Old Testament scripture reading from Genesis chapter 23.
Good morning. Sarah's death and burial. Sarah lived 127 years. These were the years of the life of Sarah. And Sarah died at Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron, in the land of Canaan. And Abraham went in to mourn for Sarah and to weep for her. And Abraham rose up from before his dead and said to the Hittites, I am a sojourner and foreigner among you. Give me a property among you for a burying place, that I may bury my dead out of my sight. The Hittites answered Abraham, Hear us, my lord. You are a prince of God among us. Bury your dead in the choices of our tombs. None of us will withhold from you his tomb to hinder you from burying your dead. Abraham rose and bowed to the Hittites, the people of the land. And he said to them, If you are willing that I should bury my dead out of my sight, hear me, and entreat for me Ephron, the son of Zohar, that he may give me the cave of Machpelah, which he owns. It is at the end of his field. For the full price, let him give it to me in your presence as property for a burying place. Now Ephron was sitting among the Hittites, and Ephron the Hittite answered Abraham in the hearing of the Hittites, of all who went in at the gates of his city. No, my lord, hear me. I give you the field, and I give you the cave that is in it. In the sight of the sons of my people, I give it to you. Bury your dead. Then Abraham bowed down before the people of the land. And he said to Ephron in the hearing of the people of the land, but if you will, hear me. I give the price of the field. Accept it from me, that I may bury my dead there. Ephron answered Abraham, my lord, listen to me. A piece of land worth 400 shekels of silver, what is that between you and me? Bury your dead. Abraham listened to Ephron, and Abraham weighed out for Ephron the silver that he had named in the hearing of the Hittites, 400 shekels of silver, according to the weights current among the merchants. So the field of Ephron in Machpelah, which was to the east of Mamre, the field with the cave that was in it, and all the trees that were in the field throughout its whole area, was made over to Abraham as a possession in the presence of the Hittites, before all who went in at the gates of his city. After this, Abraham buried Sarah, his wife, in the cave of the field of Machpelah, east of Mamre, that is Hebron, in the land of Canaan. The field and the cave that is in it were made over to Abraham as property for a burying place by the Hittites.
Thank you. We now have our New Testament reading, Matthew 23.
Good morning. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, the scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat, so do and observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do. For they preach, but do not practice. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long, and they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues, and greetings in the marketplaces, and being called rabbi by others. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all brothers. And call no man your father on earth, for you have one Father who is in heaven. Neither be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Christ. The greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, for you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte, and when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much a child of hell as yourselves. Woe to you, blind guides, who say, if anyone swears by the temple, it is nothing, but if anyone swears by the gold of the temple, he is bound by his oath. You blind fools, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that has made the gold sacred? And you say, if anyone swears by the altar, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gift that is on the altar, he is bound by his oath. You blind men, for which is greater, the gift or the altar that makes the gift sacred? So whoever swears by the altar swears by it and by everything on it. And whoever swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And whoever swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint and dill and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. These you ought to have done without neglecting the other. You blind guys, straining out a gnat and swallowing a camel. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside also may be clean. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanness. So you also outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you build the tombs of the prophets and decorate the monuments of the righteous, saying, if we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would not have taken part in them in shedding the blood of the prophets. Thus you witness against yourselves that you are the sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of your fathers. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how are you to escape being sentenced to hell? Therefore, I send you prophets and wise men and scribes, some of whom you will kill and crucify, and some you will flog in your synagogues and persecute from town to town, so that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, the son of Barakiah, whom you murdered between the sanctuary and the altar. Truly I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you are not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Thank you for those scripture readings. Again, we are reminded in the word to give attention to the public reading of scripture. And we read the words of our Savior, and how could we not also ourselves tremble at our own hypocrisy? Whenever we don't do as we are supposed to, we are hypocrites. And so Jesus invites us all to repent. At this time, we benefit from the ministry of the Berean Choir to the Lord. We invite them to minister at this time. After which, we will have our prayer of thanksgiving, our offertory prayer by our brother Gilbert Duke.
For God the just is sad.
Amen. Thank you so much, Berean Choir, encouragement in song as we reflect on our powerful Savior. At this time, we have prayer for the offering and thanksgiving. Brother Gilbert Duke, he's going back shortly, and so we invite him to pray before he and his wife leave the island.
Morning, church. My wife and I has made this church our home church away from home. And we are very comfortable and happy, and we love to worship with you. As I think about praying with thanksgiving and for the offering, someone said to me that they could not afford to give offering to the church. And my reply to them was, you cannot afford not to give. And that being said, I think of the scripture that says, and that is where I place my tithes. Every time I have my tithes, I place it in the Bible that says, will a man rob God? And the answer is that, wherewith have we robbed God? But we have robbed God in our tithes and our offerings. And then be reminded, it says, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse and prove me and see if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing where there won't be room enough to receive it. Father, we come to you this day and we present our bodies a living sacrifice. But more so, Lord, we want to present to you our gifts and our offerings. For we realize, Lord, it's not ours, it's yours. And we're so glad that you have made it possible, that you have given us the strength to work so that we can give back to you what is rightfully yours. For you have told us that God loves a cheerful giver. So God, as we come to this time, then we will look and search our hearts and ask you to direct us as to what we will give. We realize that you love a cheerful giver. We pray, O Lord, for those who don't have. We pray that you will open windows of opportunity that they may find employment to do so. And Lord, as those of us who will throw into the offering plate today, may we do so with thanksgiving, realizing from whence our help came, for our help came from the Lord which made heaven and earth. We give you praise, we give you thanks, as we pour to you our tithes and offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, while we receive the offering, we're going to sing Count Your Blessings, name them one by one. Drop your money, but we want you to clap to this song.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed.
Oh,
All God's people said? Amen. You may be seated. Bless the Lord. We're going to invite Brother Elon Richards to come and give the intercessory prayer this morning. And speaking of blessings, I just noticed the newest, well, married couple in the Berean, at least. I don't know if anybody got married since then. I see Mr. and Mrs. Kenny Sincere in the back of the media. I see Jody is ducking me. So, yes, please. There we go. Fantastic. Hey, here we go. If you could get a camera behind it, that would be fantastic. God bless you guys. Count your blessings, right? Amen.
Good morning, church. Brothers and sisters, it's wonderful that we can pray to God. He has given us a wonderful opportunity. Let us pray. Who is like unto you, O God, among the gods? Who is like you, impressive in holiness, awesome in praises, working wonders? You reach out with your hand and swallow them. In faithfulness, you have led your people to redeem. We are led by you this morning. We are grateful for your leading. We're grateful for the strength by which you guide us. We are grateful that you allow us to breathe another breath and to give you worship and to give you praise. You're deserving of it. And even as our daughter Gabrielle said, you're the best God ever. And we praise you for who you are. Indeed, we reflect on the resurrection power that you displayed in raising Christ from the dead. You orchestrated a great plan. And so as the psalmist said, this is the day that the Lord has made. You are the one that made it possible. And we continue to rejoice in resurrection power. We thank you that we can have victory over this flesh that seeks to lead us in the wrong direction. We are grateful that we have the power to live the life that you have called us to live, even through that same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. We thank you for the indwelling of Holy Spirit. We ask, Lord, that we will not quench him. We ask that you help us not to grieve him, because you are worthy to be served. You are worthy to be praised. You consider the poor. You are respectful of no person. You dispense salvation to everyone. You dispense judgment fairly to everyone. You allow your blessings to fall on the just and the unjust. And we are grateful, Lord, that you are an impartial God. And so, Father, as you have made us who were poor in spirit, we were spiritually bankrupt. We did not have the relationship with you. We were lost and going to hell. And you saved us. You made us rich in Christ. And so this morning we rejoice in the great salvation, in the riches that you have bestowed upon us through Christ. We thank you, Lord, that we can consider the poor. And even as the psalmist shows in Psalm 41, that those who consider the poor, Lord, you will allow your provision to be rich towards them, your protection, and even your pardon. We thank you for those that are with us who are aging. We recognize those who are weak in body, weak in health due to aging, due to sickness. And we ask, Lord, that you would touch our people, Lord, that are aching, that are grieving because of this physical pain. Give them relief. Give them comfort. Give them help. Cause your presence to be felt, Lord, that they may know you are by their sick bed and that you are able to restore them to full health. To your glory, Lord, do this. Remember those who are poor, even in emotion, who have suffered loss, those who are struggling with circumstances that cause their continence to just drop. May you refresh them. May you restore them. May you help them. May you comfort them as only you can. We ask, Lord, that we, your people, will be able to comfort each other, even as your word shows, and be a blessing to each other in these times. Remember those who are poor, even financially, those who don't have jobs, Lord. Open doors for them. Cause them to see how they can make wealth with the gifts that you've given them, the abilities that you've given them. Give them favor, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Continue to keep them as you have promised that you would allow us to dwell in the land. And so, Father, we commit them to you. We ask, Lord, that you would help those who are working, Lord, to be and still falling short. We ask that you would provide, that you would help them to be able to balance their expenses with their income. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to provide. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to pardon those who are weak even in their spiritual walk, those who are struggling in their faith. Lord, strengthen their faith. Restore those that are weak among us, Lord, who are floundering, who don't find the desire to pray or the desire to read your word or the desire to fellowship. Restore such, Lord. Heal such and cause them to be able to glorify your wonderful name. Those who are not saved in our families, Lord, save our families. Save our brothers. Save our mothers. Save our children. Deliver them from the hand of the enemy, Lord. You're the only one that can save, and you're the great savior of all mankind. Save our children, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to do these things, answer our prayers, that you might be shown to be the God that is all-powerful, that you may show yourself to be the God who is, that has the authority and the power to do all that we ask. We ask, Lord, that you would show that you reign even as you answer our prayers. Even as our prayers are answered, we pray, Lord, that you would be that God that is praised for all that you are. You're worthy to be praised. So even as you work through us to demonstrate your goodness, may we continue to commit ourselves to you. We think of other churches who are preaching the gospel. We pray, Lord, that you would strengthen their witness. We pray, Lord, that they would dispense your truth in love and in graciousness, and that they would not forsake their first love. We can easily get carried away with preaching the truth and yet forsake the first love, you, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you will help us, that we will not be such, that we will continue to love you, that we will continue to seek you. Indeed, the end of the commandments, the truth, is about loving you. So may we, as we learn your word, may we continue to love you more. As we see the great God that you are, may our faith be built up and put our full confidence in you, that we might see that you are that God, that your love is steadfast. Even when we aren't faithful, you remain faithful. So may our witnesses as churches in this island be strong, even in the midst of the evil that we see in our land, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would restrain the evil. We are seeing robberies increase. We are seeing people taken advantage of. Oh, that you will arrest the hearts of these men, of these women, whoever they are. But generally restrain the hand of the enemy who is working in them to commit these crimes, Lord. Cause crime to subside. Restrain it in the name of Jesus. And as we have the opportunity to speak to those who are lost, may we seize that opportunity, because when we save someone, we save them from a multitude of sins, even the sins of robbery and the sins of evil. We ask, Lord, that you would be merciful to our land. Help our government to rule in a way that is righteous. We ask, Lord, that you remember them, Lord. That we can continue to worship you freely. We thank you for this wonderful opportunity. So, Lord, we pray that you will so move in the hearts of our leaders that they may not allow anyone to distract them from allowing your people who are serving the true and living God. May there be an understanding that there's only one God, the true and the living God, the God of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so may you raise up men that are able to speak and to give counsel in this regard and to lead us in a direction that pleases you. For a nation that honors you is in good hands. And so, Father, we commit our government into your hands. We pray, Lord, that you will continue, Lord, to remember those around the world that are suffering for the name of Christ. We think of those that are in India, those that are in China, in Africa, who are experiencing violence at the hands of Muslims and Hindus, radicals, and even governments that seek to snuff out the gospel. But your word will prevail. We thank you, Lord, that we are on the winning side, that we are overcomers because of the salvation that you have given to us. We're not trying to be overcomers. We are overcomers because we are born again. And so, Father, in this mindset, Lord, we continue to trust you to do your will across the world and remember our brothers and sisters as they suffer, given the grace to go through what they have to go through, given the strength, Lord, give them the courage to face it. And may they continue also in their own sphere to share the gospel, which is able to deliver men from their sins. So we ask, Lord, that you would continue to help us to look to you, Lord. We thank you for your Son, the Lamb, who was slain from the foundation of the world, who is the one that will eventually be the Lamb who exercises his wrath even on evil. But as we wait for that coming, help us to keep our eyes on you, on him. And even as you say in Revelation, that you come quickly. Even so, Lord, we say come, because we look to you with expectancy to deliver us even from this flesh and bring us into the presence of yourself, that we may all continue to rejoice in your goodness and in your love and all your blessings that you have bestowed upon us. So continue to take full control of this service as you are the God that is worthy of all praise. And you're the best God ever. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Elon. Let's all stand as we sing, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus," the first and the last stanza before we go into God's word briefly this morning. If you have your Bible, go ahead and open it to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 21 is where we are, verse 17 through to verse 26. Again, what we are seeing is the Apostle Paul, having been told of God and warned concerning the final phases of his ministry endeavor. And so he's continued to journey. And, of course, he is doing that on purpose by meeting with the church's leaders wherever he goes. And so it was his desire to get to Jerusalem as soon as possible before Pentecost, which demonstrates his commitment still to the Jewish festivals and so on, which is actually key for this passage. And so in verse 17 of Acts chapter 21, we're going to read that when we had come to Jerusalem, the brothers received us gladly. On the following day, Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. After greeting them, he related one by one the things that God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. And when they heard it, they glorified God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for just a blessing of your word. Thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity to pray to you and to do so intentionally, focusing on praise and confession and thanksgiving and intercession this morning. We pray, now, Lord God, for your illumination by way of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we desire to see the text for what it is, and we are able to do that and understand it because we have the indwelling Holy Spirit. We are seeking to discern spiritual things here this morning. And so we ask, Lord, that as we examine the impact of the gospel in various cultures, that we would make the appropriate application to our day. Lord, help us, humble us. We pray, Lord, as we study this text now, in Jesus' name, amen. So he's come to Jerusalem. And what we're going to observe, guys, is that as Christians, if we're honest, we struggle with the norms or the habits or the traditions or the customs that we had in place before we came to Christ. Some things we struggle to let go. Some things we wonder if we should let them go or let them continue. And that is what is taking place here. But first of all, there is a good note of rejoicing in the gospel. So the gospel brings rejoicing. And that's what we see in verses 17 through to verse 20, the first part that we read. When they had come to Jerusalem, what happened? They were received gladly. And that is testimony to the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, where the apostle to the Gentiles can return to Jerusalem. This is a largely, of course, ethnically Jewish area, and be well received. It continues to demonstrate that the gospel of Jesus Christ crosses those boundaries and pushes through those barriers for the kingdom. There is joy that he is there. And so he continues to testify. He meets with James. James is the leader of the Jerusalem church, Jesus' own half-brother. And in greeting them, what does he do in verse 19? He tells them one by one everything that the Lord has done. Sounds like count your blessings, isn't it? And so it is not then inappropriate to recall and to reflect and to share the wonderful things that God has done in ministry. It is not boasting or bragging in a sinful way. Indeed, we boast in Christ and what he has done. And that is appropriate. And notice, there is no sense here of any jealousy, right? So these are how the churches over there are doing, and all of these things have happened. And we don't get from James and the elders of the Jerusalem church that they're pushing up their nose and they're feeling bad because maybe they are not seeing the move of God in their place. We don't see any of that, right? So there is no competition. Then, of course, it's so helpful that this is a church that Paul is revisiting, right? He's revisiting this area, so he knows what they are about. But certainly, as we make application to our day, folks, we ought to be thankful, as we prayed, when healthy churches in our land grow and expand. Isn't that what we want? Maybe we want more churches who believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those are the churches that we want to prosper. Those are the churches that we want to be mega churches. Imagine a mega church that preaches the word of God, right? That's what we want. That's what we desire. So it's not about competition. It's about cooperation. And so that's why we make a concerted effort here in our service to pray by name for pastors and other ministries of healthy churches, and indeed those who are not healthy, those who have practices that are not in alignment with the Bible. We pray for them too. Right? We pray that they will come to walk in a straight line, orthodox, right? Come to walk in a straight line with the gospel. So there's gospel rejoicing in these opening verses, right? And then we see that there is some difficulty. And that's how it goes, guys. I don't want you to be pessimistic, but when things are going well, then sometimes you don't want to have that, right? You set yourself up for that, but it's like, what's going to happen now? So that's what we see happening here. They said to him, you see, brother, verse 20, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed. Right? So this is what this situation, that's what's going on over there. We are so thankful for what God is doing among the Gentiles. Can I tell you something? God is saving thousands of Jews here, right? Probably hyperbole to me, what? A lot, right? So God is working here mightily also. They are all zealous for the law. So right away now, we have the theme of law and gospel coming out, verse 21. And here's the thing, Paul. They have been told about you that you teach all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses. There is a rumor that is spreading that you are telling them not to circumcise their children or walk according to our customs. The word of God is proclaimed and the gospel is preached. These things can happen. There can be rumors that are spread. There are misunderstandings and misgivings. And then the question of verse 22 comes in. What then is to be done when these things happen? So they will certainly hear that you have come. They say, wait, Paul is in Jerusalem? This person that we are hearing is out there preaching that we should dismiss our customs and our traditions and the things that we love so dearly, the things that we grew up with. This man is here. And James and the elders of the church are showing love to the apostle by letting him know what the issues are. Okay, so two things I want to do at this point. I want to pause a minute because I want to make application to our day, but I want you to help me to do it. So, do we have traditions in our culture? So that's the church, you know, the churches in Ephesus and Galatia and Corinth, right? So, and then come back home, church in Jerusalem, all right? So the church in Hadazel, all right? So do we have traditions in our church? Do we have traditions as Barbadians? What's a Bajan tradition? Bajan tradition. That's the first thing I talk about. So on Saturday, pudding and sour. So somebody remember that, right? Because you can come back at that at the end, right? What's another tradition? Flying kite, somebody say. All right, remember these, you know. We're coming back to them. Yes. Landship. Okay, yes, landship. All right. Yes, Gabrielle. Maypole. Landship, maypole, right? Yeah, whoa, they're really sharp on this. What else? Any traditions? Easter. Y'all, that's how Easter weekend. Not supposed to eat what? Don't know what we're talking about because, All right. So you're not supposed to eat chicken. It's only fish, right? Something. It's only fish, right? These only what? Fish. Only fish on Good Friday is what it is. Okay. Right. And sorry. You can't go to the beach either. We went to the beach. Okay. Okay. Right. So we are not Chris. Yeah. Yes, clean the house, pull down the house, yes. Right, so we acknowledge that there's stuff that we have that we value. There's stuff that we have that we are accustomed to. There are practices and habits and traditions. Are there any summer traditions that we have? Anything that we are told is our culture? August? Oh, sorry, what? Kropova? Kiddies Kadumit? Yes, come through Lenten season. Yes, Dorothy? Conkeys, okay. With or without raisins? Leave that one alone. We leave that for November. All right? Lenten season, you may have come from a background where it's at the beginning. You have Ash Wednesday. What happens on Ash Wednesday? You put the cross on your forehead. All right? You may have come from that background. Anybody come from that background? Some people, right, yeah? We got the ash on your forehead, all right? So again, we acknowledge that they are traditions, and I want us to think about those when we come to the end to kind of sort them out, all right? So there are Jewish customs and traditions that, you know, the Jews, they feel threatened. They feel as though this gospel of grace is saying, dismiss all of these things. They're worthless and unimportant. And certainly there is there is an understanding. You can kind of understand when you read the Apostle Paul why people might draw that conclusion, right? Because he is very clear about the purpose of the law now since Christ has come, right? And so what was the purpose of the law? Law was our, anybody know? Was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, right? But he testifies that the law is what? The law is good. The law is good. The law is good for what it is intended. And so, just trying to find the reference here that I have, but I can't find it here, no. Right, but there you can see from his teaching that you can draw that, you have an understanding why the rumor spread, right? So the best rumors, quote-unquote gossip, they have a little bit of what? A little bit of truth in them, right? And so you can see how people can misconstrue what he was actually saying about the law. And so James, understanding that he wasn't completely dismissing the law, makes a recommendation as to how this can be handled. This is a rumor that needs to be dealt with wisely, right? So it isn't that Paul is teaching non-observance of the law, but certainly he is teaching that it is not something that needs to be insisted on by the Gentiles. And so teaching and preaching to the Gentiles and telling them, you guys don't need to keep the law, the rumor has spread that what? The law and its customs are irrelevant and to be dismissed. All right? So then we see the action plan. What is the action plan? It says, verse 22, what is to be done? You are here. People know you're here. This is going to be bad if we do not address this rumor, this false rumor that is spreading. All right, and so he says what? Do therefore, verse 23, do therefore what we tell you. We have four men who are under a vow. The specifics, the background here, not clear among any of the authors, the scholarship. So we don't know why they are engaging in this vow, but from the description of it, it seems as though it is some form of a Nazarite vow, right? So the under vow, verse 24, take these men and purify yourself along with them, right? Part of the thinking is that when you have come back or returned from traveling through Gentile lands, you need to cleanse yourself ceremonially. That could be, and it is likely, but we're not sure, right? So purify yourself along with them and pay their expenses so that they may shave their heads. So basically, submit and subject yourself to Jewish law and customs and do it with these people who are taking this opportunity right now so that everybody would know where you stand as it relates to the law. All will know that there is nothing in what they have been told about you, but that you yourself also live in observance of the law. So pause a minute. Paul is out there preaching to Gentiles, and he's saying, you guys don't need to follow these customs, practices, traditions. He comes back to Jerusalem. James says, people are upset. They think that you're trying to get rid of everything that is dear to them. James makes a recommendation to Paul. These are church leaders talking, yeah? Paul says, I'm fine with that. Does that sound like a hypocritical compromise to you? It can have that tension. So how do we resolve that? Right? We're over here. I do one thing over here. I do something completely different. I preach and practice one thing over here. And then over here, I do something that is opposite to that. How do we resolve that? Well, the context matters. So when it comes to the gospel, the one thing that we don't do is compromise the gospel message. All right? When it comes to, so no matter how enthusiastic you are for the salvation of souls and lost sinners, the one thing we don't do is twist, manipulate the gospel message. If you do that, you don't have the gospel anymore. If you add to the gospel, it's not the gospel. If you subtract from the gospel, it's not the gospel. Right? And so that's what's happening now. There are people who desire to have churches filled. Is that a good desire? Yeah. Right? But they are doing it with a message that is not the gospel, and therefore we have a lot of people who believe that they are Christians and they are not. Believe that they are redeemed, but they are not. Because they do not have the truth of the gospel. They have a twisted message and version of it. And that is scary, and that is sobering. And so the one thing that we don't do in missions is compromise the message of the gospel. But in terms of how we contextualize the gospel, when we come to a particular area, there are things, practices that we can adopt so that we ourselves are not an obstacle to the gospel's advance. All right? So if I come into a conservative community, I don't know if they can describe Berean as such, but let's go for it. All right? So how do we dress for church on Sunday? Typical, right? Jacket, shirt, tie. Gone clear, right? Everybody goes, he looked like a pastor, all right? But if I were in another context, let's say we're meeting at the beach somewhere, it's not likely that I'd be wearing this, right? There are people who will dress differently, right? The Christians in the Philippines, the Christians in Hawaii, when they gather for church outside in the searing heat, they're not dressed like this. And does that make them less Christian than us? Are we more Christian than them because we got a hand jacket, three-piece suit? Okay. All right? So we understand that the message of the gospel is what matters. And so that is why then in context, once the practice does not violate the message of the gospel, then it is fine to proceed with it. All right? So we have scripture where Peter contradicted the message of the gospel because he was fellowshipping with Gentiles. When the Jews came down, he pulled away from Gentiles. Does that violate the message of the gospel? Yes. Why? Because there's no Jew or Greek. We're all one in Christ. So there's no partiality. That practice compromises the gospel. But traditions as it relates to washing and cleanliness, that's fine in this context, right? And so Paul is able, I got 1 Corinthians. Paul is able to follow this advice from James, right? And to submit again willingly, right? He's not grudgingly doing this to the practice that will bring about gospel advance. Verse 25 says, as for the Gentiles who have believed, we have sent a letter with our judgment on what they should do and how they should behave, right? So the Gentiles are sorted out. They're coming from backgrounds that are so starkly different to ours that, yes, we know Jerusalem Council, we have already worked through those issues. What were the issues? We sent a letter with our judgment that they should abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols, from blood, what has been strangled, from sexual immorality. Those are the things that they were battling with. Those are the things that they were dealing with. Those four needed to be addressed, right? Those are the Gentiles. The question is, how do the Jews then live? How do those who are quote-unquote near to the gospel live? And this is upsetting not just, this is upsetting unbelieving and believing Jews. So what does Paul do? Paul, verse 26, took the men, and the next day he purified himself along with them and went into the temple, giving notice when the days of purification will be fulfilled and the offering presented for each one of them. Paul does what he has to do in order for the gospel to advance, right? So long as there is no compromise of the gospel, he is able to align himself with this plan, practice, this tradition, this custom, once it does not violate the gospel. It demonstrates love and humility. And so I'm drawing from this text that believers do struggle with the norms of their life before Christ, but because the Lord unites all ethnic groups in the church, you must practice love and humility in conflict over cultural differences, right? And so you said we got different backgrounds. People have sauce on a Saturday. Some of y'all eating a whole chicken on Good Friday, right? Like we have different backgrounds and different. So how do we work through those difficulties and differences with love and humility, right? As exemplified by Paul and James, church leaders, powerful, empowered by the Holy Spirit, given the authority in their own right, able to establish themselves and hold their own. And how do they interact with each other, right? This is a clash here of authority. And James is able, he doesn't, what does James do? Paul, you're being reckless. Does he grab him and shake him, right? He comes and says, hey, we praise God. Hey, listen, God doing a marvelous thing here. I want to let you know what people are saying about you, though. And not just that, here's how I think that we can get through and rectify this problem. Here's the plan. What is Paul's response? Who? Well, I didn't care what he said. Let the haters hate. Haters will hate, right? You don't see, but you don't see that. You see him saying, all right, if this secondary, maybe tertiary issue is going to be a major obstacle to the gospel, that's absolutely fine. I will submit myself to this plan of observing the Jew. You understand? And that is how we ought to be, whereby our commitment to gospel advance is such that we ourselves will not allow ourselves to get into the way of gospel advance. We can talk about the weaker brother and all that another time, Romans 14. Somebody desire to do that with you, because we do have those issues in our church, as all churches do. But what Paul is being asked to do, I want to leave us with this, is to act, somebody says, with cultural sensitivity to the context that he now finds himself in. Without compromising the gospel, he's willing to do anything for the sake of the unity that it might create. So when we then want to engage people with the gospel, there are neutral practices that are culturally driven. Do you agree with that? That there are neutral practices? So on the big subject of music, let's do this really quick, right? I know there's a big discussion whether music is amoral, or there's a morality attached to music, right? In other words, if music all by itself can be good or bad, right? Or is it just sound waves and there's no morality attached to music? All right? What are your thoughts? Okay, so is it okay for a Christian to sing the alphabet song? Boy, there's nothing in there that talks about Jesus. Unless you use the letters to spell, right? You say, I just gave you all the letters, so you know Jesus is in there somewhere. So, right? So it's legitimate. But isn't it also the case that all the other letters are in there to form all the other words that were sung at Spice's concert last night that y'all don't know anything about? You understand what I'm saying? So we have to make decisions culturally like this. It's okay to sing the alphabet song. There are things that are neutral. We go overboard with this, man, where we try to demonize all sorts of stuff there's no problem with it. It's not a primary issue. It's not even secondary or tertiary. So there are neutral practices that are culturally driven. We need to exercise discernment in what we will love, because all things are lawful, but not everything is expedient. So when it comes to sauce on a Saturday, you say, Christian liberty, bring all the sauce. But it may not be expedient for you to do that if, in your context, the sauce on Saturday is also associated with alcohol and drunkenness. Right? It may not be expedient for you to do that, right? So again, we need to exercise our discernment so that we don't get into the way of gospel advance. What else y'all told me about? Conkeys, with or without raisins, just dismiss it because that's a fight. So, you know, just don't eat conkeys anymore. What about the ash? What about somebody says, I'm a Christian, I've come to faith, but my background and tradition is going and getting the ash on my forehead. So the Christian, go ahead and get the ash on the forehead. What do you think? Is that a sin issue? It's a cultural thing. Is it a sin issue? I can't see it as a sin issue. Is it expedient to do that? It seems to me it has a kind of external or outward, right? Like how the worldly Pharisees and scribes, this outward kind of manifestation, but really inwardly is what you need to be dealing with, right? So you get the cross or don't get the cross, you need to live a holy life. And so why I would stay away from it is because people think that once they do that, they're okay. I have no regard for reading God's word faithfully or right? And again, that's a call that you got to make, right? If you enter into some kind of foreign field and you know that tradition, whether it's Roman Catholic, Anglican, is strong there, you might do that in order to integrate and then show them why this stuff really isn't as important as you think it is, right? But you have to make those judgment calls. What about somebody who their family has come up Hindu? I have a word, but I didn't get to research it. Is it Diwali? What's that? Diwali is a festival, right? Okay, so I'm a Christian, but it's time for Diwali, and so Pastor can be out for a couple days. acceptable? Sin issue? Why? Sin issue, why? What is paganism? Right, so you understand that as we live as Christians, we have to consider what are sin issues and what are not sin issues. That's a sin issue. So I have a culture, and again, you guys know what I believe Scripture teaches. Love not the world, and things are in the world. When it comes to corporal vocadument, sorry. No, please. Right? I think it's a violation of the word of God for you to participate in crop over. To jump for kadumet. Right? Like that. It's the works of the flesh. All right? So understand because, but we argue, what our argument is culture. Well, that's what I come up with. But remember, we're called out of darkness into light. So we got to walk away and dismiss all those things that are an issue. So, regarding the gospel advance, I could dress up or I could dress down for the sake of the gospel. Right? I can dress up or dress down for the sake of the gospel. God, there's that freedom. All right? Let me finish this real quick. All right? So those neutral practices we talked about, we got to discern, but there are things that are sin. But Scripture never tells you to accommodate what is sinful in your missionary endeavor. You want to prevent unnecessary static from getting in the way of sharing the gospel and doing damage to the unity of the church, somebody says. It represents a curbing of freedoms. If the most important thing to you is your Christian freedom, then you're not going to get very far in your gospel witness. Because you are called over and over to sacrifice those freedoms for the sake of the gospel. In fact, somebody says it this way, a truly emancipated spirit, or free, like Paul's, is not in bondage to its own freedom or emancipation. Right? Christian liberty is a great thing, but sometimes the expression of that liberty can be counterproductive. Just because you can does not mean that you should, Christian. So that is what Paul saw was at stake when James, who was in that context, says this is what's going on and this is how you need to make this clear, Paul, because this rumor is spreading and it needs to be addressed. So we need that kind of generous spirit when we bring stuff to each other to talk about, right? When you stand for the gospel and you preach the word of God, people are going to take you the wrong way. If you preach and teach as we do, and uphold, as the scriptures teach, we have it in our constitution, that elders must be men, right? Pastors must be men. The rumor will spread that we don't like women. Rubbish, right? So you can see how these things can happen. And you do what you need to correct that misunderstanding, but certainly we don't compromise the teaching of God's word in any way. So, as we share the word and make disciples, don't compromise the word. But take every opportunity to share, even if it means sacrificing your freedoms. Right? Coming down a bit or dressing up a bit. For the sake of the gospel and sharing the message, let's do that for the glory of God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning to us. Thank you, Lord God, that we are able to benefit from a community of believers here who want to get the word of God out. Lord, sometimes we have stumbled in this area because of our gospel presentation. Sometimes the way we present ourselves or present the gospel, we make it seem as though there's some kind of extra barrier or hurdle to get over to become a Christian. And forgive us where we have added to the gospel in that way. Lord, forgive us where we have made a gospel presentation that makes it seem really light and kind of like easy. It doesn't really talk about repenting or turning from sin. A kind of loose come as you are and something nebulous, but not really rooted in the truth of the gospel message. Forgive us where we have done that also. Forgive us where by our behavior, by our practice, by our conduct, by our attitudes, we have turned off people from the gospel, right? We have illegitimately, by our sinful practices, have turned off others and they don't want anything to do with the Lord because of our behavior. Forgive us for not loving on each other and therefore then being a good witness and testimony to the world around us that Jesus Christ is the one who unites. Jesus Christ is the one who transforms and that this is a community of people who would not otherwise be together if not for the gospel. Those who are from different backgrounds and customs, practices, sinful or just neutral but dominant, right? We just pray, God, that our church would be one that continues to kind of integrate with one another. We are members one of the other. And so we pray that, we will lean into that vulnerability to invite other believers into our spaces, into our lives, and we would care for them and inquire about them and share with them and pray for one another and bear one another's burdens, right? So that, and yes, then when these issues arise, these conflicts of tradition and preference, and custom arise, we would tackle these things and handle them with love and humility. Love and humility that will honor you, O Lord. And so we thank you for this reminder and encouragement that we can receive this morning to continue to grow in our discipleship. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless the Lord. We're going to transition now into the Lord's table. You say, Pastor, I thought we had communion last week. As often as you do it in remembrance of me. Now, that's deliberate. That's intentional. We thought about it ahead of time. We were actually thinking about doing communion on Good Friday, skipping the Easter Sunday, and then doing it this week. But it is tradition to take communion on Easter Sunday. So we kept it. Amen. And now we take it again next Sunday. And I don't know if you can do it next Sunday. All right? But we're going to sing the song we love to sing now, the communion hymn. We'll do... What did we say? We do one stanza of it and then transition into Lord's table. You can remain seated. So we're going to sing stanzas of the song throughout the communion. Behold the Lamb.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us.
Bonds of peace that bring us together. And Gentile church, Jerusalem, Jewish church, all one church in Christ. And so you may be outside of the church this morning. You may not know the salvation that we have and that we rejoice in. And so I want to make it clear that invitation is there for you. If you don't know Jesus, now is the time to trust him. Now is the time to come to him in repentance and faith. Believe the gospel, right? He is the one who is able to forgive and cleanse. So all of your good works, your good deeds, they fall flat because there's only one righteous, Jesus. So I invite you to know him. I invite you to confess your sin to him and trust him for the salvation of your soul. Respond to the light that the Holy Spirit is giving to you. Lord's table is for those who have responded to that light, who have received Christ as Savior. It is for Christians only. There might be a tradition and a custom in other churches to take Lord's table. You know, even if you're not a believer, just take it. It's very open, but that's not our practice here. This is for Christian people. So Christians rejoice because we get to partake and share in this wonderful provision. If you were not able to receive the pre-filled cup and wafer, you can raise your hand and the ushers will bring that to you at this time. All right, let's go ahead and have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for instructing us, for leaving us a plan to follow. After we are saved, we are to be baptized. After we are baptized, we are to be members of the church. Certainly, we all through that experience, we are to be remembering Christ. And we do that largely through this ordinance of the Lord's table, Lord's Supper. And so we pray that as we partake, we remember Jesus. We just recently come through an intentional season in our culture of remembering his death, his burial, his resurrection, his passive obedience, his active obedience, his submission to the cross, his always submitting to the Holy Spirit throughout his life. Thank you, Lord God, that he bore our sin in his body, submitting himself to the curse, even death on a tree. And so, Lord God, we thank you for this provision of a marvelous Savior. We pray, God, that as we partake of these elements, that you will bless them, and that, you know, we will benefit from the grace that comes by way of obedience, not that the elements themselves instill grace, but that because we obey, there is joy in obedience. Thank you for that, God. So I pray, Lord, that as we sing, we remind ourselves of the importance of the body that was broken. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll sing stanza 2. So we share in this bread of life. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life. Pay the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of this sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King. Amen. Now, as they were eating, Jesus took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." Shall we eat the bread together? Amen. Stanza 3. Is every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drained this cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of grace. And he took a cup, when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Shall we drink the cup together? All God's people said, amen. Remember that at this time, we also receive that collection for those who are our shut-ins. And so you can make that deposit on your way out in the relevant container. Let's all stand together, everybody. And we're going to close with the final stanza of that selection at this time.
And so with thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. As we share suffering, we proclaim Christ will come again, and we'll join in the feast of heaven around the table of the King.
As we share
in his suffering, Christ will come again, and we'll join in the feast of heaven around the table of the King. Around the table of the King. Around the table. Let's close in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, thank you so very much for your word. It is good to be in the house of the Lord, Father, and to hear, to have the opportunity to worship you. Pray, Father, as we leave this place, that you will go with us, that we'll remember what we've heard today, and that we'll apply it to our lives, Father, that we'll put the gospel message first and all that we say and all that we do. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.